Ah, yes, the perfect symbol of American manhood. The star of cinema's western, the genre that defined masculinity for decades. The independent hero, free of the confines of domestic life, living alone on the range. However, this is not a cowboy.
Cowboys frequently, secretly fond of each other. Say, what do you think all them saddles and boots was about?
This is John Wayne, the actor who is essential to the American Western. He was the Golden Age cowboy and era of Western filmmaking, particularly responsible for glorifying the idea of a cowboy as a tough, independent, and most importantly, proper, manly man. He was the horse-riding, gun-slinging American cowboy ideal, which originated as an escapist fantasy for a generation recovering from World War I. This ideal originated as early as the late 1800s. However, this was when a variety of changes were occurring in the U.S., such as urbanization, women's independence, immigration, and other troubling issues for those living in the establishment. According to Redressing America's Frontier Past, a novel by Western historian Peter Boag, Americans looked to their so-called frontier past for solace from these new and frightening changes. These ideals rewrote the entire concept of a cowboy in American history. In reality, cowboys were overworked, underfed, and underpaid. They were most often people of color, folks looking to make a better life for themselves on the range. Most shocking, however, to those who idealize the myth of the cowboy is the fact that he was most likely queer. What I find most ironic in this transition from the frontier reality to the fantasy we know today is that the romanticized cowboy was used as escapism from the scary, diverse new ideas and people coming to the forefront in America. But the real cowboy communities were full of these kind of folks. So, this is a cowboy. This is a cowboy. This is a cowboy. I mean, this is a cowboy. If you count a gay horse kid from Kentucky, I can throw a mean lasso, so. Let's start this conversation where it all started, in the Old West. First and foremost, I want to give a huge credit to a big part of the inspiration for this section and where I found a lot of these stories from queer cowboy history, Kaz Rowe. I linked their video here as well as in the bio, but unfortunately so many of these stories are so difficult to find. Queerness has been notoriously covered up in so many aspects of American history, and I'm so grateful to Rowe's video for uncovering and compiling so many of these incredible stories. Secondly, I want to establish another crucial aspect of this history. The West wasn't wild, it wasn't land in need of settling or colonizing, and cowboys originated in a deeply problematic West responsible for the genocide and displacement of the Native people living there. Just because I believe it's important to uncover the queer stories erased from history, these stories cannot be told without acknowledging the people who were there first. With both of these points in mind, let's get started into the history of the queer cowboy. Like I mentioned before, cowboys were laborers who, more likely than not, were formerly enslaved, formerly incarcerated, or otherwise outcasted from society and looking for a better life. Life on the range was lonely. Cowboys lived and worked in small groups, most likely devoid entirely of women, which made intimate relationships with men a necessity, if anything. But there are many examples of very intimate queer relationships in the Old West, as well as cowboys living outside the gender binary. The only part of the mythos of the cowboy that is partly true is that he's depicted blazing his own path and challenging the norms of society at the time. This is the part of the cowboy that many queer folk, like myself, identify with in modern times, but it turns out there's a lot more there to identify with. In the late 19th century, as colonizers continued to fight for control over society, the term homosexual was coined and understood to be unnatural. Gender roles became more rigid and more like what we know of them today, and anything outside the norm was seen as an unfortunate byproduct of modern living. However, the lack of records about homosexuality and people living outside the gender binary in the early frontier have a lot more to do with the fact that these terms and ideas didn't really even exist yet than these people just not existing at all. Because let me tell you, they definitely did. Political and social changes in the mid to late 1800s formed new ideas that the sexes were not only distinctly different, but were even seen to be complete opposites for the first time. Before this, however, the two sexes were basically seen to be the same beside their sex organs, of course. Being queer back then didn't really matter a whole lot, as long as you weren't going too out far outside the societal norms, most importantly with things such as marriage and gender presentation. Otherwise, though, especially for cowboys who would go months at a time outside of towns, who only spent time with small groups of other men, they would often hook up with each other simply because of the lack of women. It was common practice for cowboys to get out sexual frustrations, and it was not only initiated by queer people. But these small groups also gave way to partnerships forming between men on the range, like sort of a co-workers with benefits kind of situation. But sometimes these partnerships would turn into relationships, whether for financial reasons, such as combining their small incomes and sharing things like food and shelter, or for more romantic reasons, or most likely both. In Badger Clark's The Lost Partner, a poem written in the 1900s and one of the most heartbreaking sources I found for this essay, Clark discusses his late lover and life without him on the range. He states, "We loved each other in the way men do, and never spoke about it, Al and me. But we both knowed, and knowing so true, was more than any woman's kiss could be." In the poem, he discusses losing Al, saying, "When we had always trailed it side by side, he went and left me here." And he goes on to say, "He'd miss the sunny range he used to ride, and he'd miss me the same I do him." If anything, I want this essay to make clear that stories like Badger and Owl's were not uncommon, and these romantic tragedies of history deserve to be told and known. Gay cowboys were far from the only examples of queerness on the frontier, though. There were lesbians who were even harder to pin down than the gay men, because they were commonly seen as invalid due to a lack of men present in the relationship. And much less threatening than relationships between men, so lesbians would usually just lay low and were rarely documented at all. Plus, it was common for more ambitious women to dress as male cowboys in order to marry women, to have more opportunities outside of their gender norm, or of course, to commit crimes without being identified. Or all three. One of the best and most documented cases of this is Harry Allen, who was born a woman but is better defined as trans male. In 1908, the Seattle Sunday Times interviewed Allen asking about his gender presentation, and he said, "I did not like to be a girl, did not feel like a girl, and never did look like a girl, so it seemed impossible to make myself a girl, and sick at heart over the thought that I would be an outcast of the feminine gender, I conceived the idea of making myself a man." Described as lady killer, bootlegger, a bronco buster, a saloon brawler, hard drinker, and an all-around rabble-rouser, Allen was one of the many cowboys who weren't assigned male at birth. Often, trans cowpoke sexes weren't found out until after their deaths, but in cases like Allen's, he enjoyed using his identity to fascinate the press. Queerness, it seems, was not only present on the frontier, but it was relatively common. As previously established, there were, and still are, plenty of narratives romanticizing life out west. Even during the height of the Old West, narratives of the free and open Wild West made their ways eastward. According to Boag, it wasn't that this time and place was more open or accepting of trans people, but that it was more diffused and unruly, which may have enabled more people to live according to their true identities. My theory is that people who were transgender in the East could read these stories that gave kind of a validation to their lives. They saw the West as a place where they could live and get jobs and carry on a life that they couldn't have in the more congested East. So the West became a place for queer folks from all over the US to be themselves and live out their identities as they see fit. Despite the fact that this was easier than it was out East, it didn't change the fact that being queer was still outlawed and difficult. Those who pressed the law too far with their identities were tracked down and prosecuted by the police. However, at the same time, one of the most fascinating aspects of this history is the fact that despite all of this difficulty, people would still do whatever it took to live their life as their true selves. For example, Alice Baker, who was a trans female school teacher who was assigned male at birth, ran from the law after being reported to the police for being trans and ended up picking up and moving a half a dozen times. In the book, Boeg states, "I had evidence that place after place and year after year she survived. She was clearly someone who really struggled and succeeded despite all of the setbacks that came with being herself." So what do we make of all of this? Between these themes of toxic masculinity, false idealizations of our past, and queerness standing strong and proud throughout so many facets of history, there's so much of the queer history of the West teaches us about our world as a whole. It teaches us to question our definitions of gender and sex and open to understanding these ideas as constructs invented by colonizers looking to control society. It teaches us to question what we know about our history and the ideas and idealizations we have about that history. For example, think of Make America Great Again, an idea that mirrors the false escapist fantasy those in the 20th century had about our perfect American traditional Old West. It begs the question, was post-colonialism America ever great? It teaches us to look between the lines for queerness in our history because you never know what untold stories are yet to be discovered. I see the future of queer cowboys as a future with more inclusive storytelling instead of relying on outdated idealizations and fantasies. However, instead of simply rewriting these histories as queer and trying to establish new systems, we should just remain open-minded to the possibilities of these communities and what's to come. But similar to Rowe's point from the end of their video essay, this uncovering and understanding of the queer presence in Western culture is not to argue a sense of pride in the colonizing and genocide during Western expansion. As critical as it is to bring light to the fact that these cultures of people, many of which are marginalized, were starting a new life for themselves and are so much more diverse than the hyper-masculine hero of the West shown today, it is still just as crucial to recognize the stories and experiences of the indigenous populations and not to continue the erasure of these groups. Cowboys were still colonizers and complicit in the genocide and forced removal of the native people of the West. As author Jennifer McLeachy writes in her article titled Lesbian Rangers on a Queer Frontier, "As lost as we may initially feel in a landscape that is no longer governed by predictable rules of heteronormativity, the welcoming of this unknown may be more crucial than any attempts at undoing the tidy borders of settler patriarchy defined order in order to replace it with a new order." So maybe this is not a cowboy, but maybe this is a cowboy too. And this, and this, and this, and this, and this. Yeehaw, y'all. Stay open-minded, giddy up, and remember, this town's big enough for all of us. Thanks for watching.